Welcome back to The Breakfast and Plus CV Africa. Time for Off the Press. We have GD Johnson joining the conversation this morning, and he will be analyzing some of the top stories. Good morning, GD Johnson.
Good morning, Mercy. It's a merciful season. And as I welcome back to the Friday beat.
Thank you.
And good morning to our viewers all over the world. Merry Christmas.
Same
and Happy New Year in advance.
Same to you.
It's a wonderful season.
All right, so let's take a look at the Daily Independent newspaper this morning. We're starting off with the bold caption. We are in final phase of battle against terrorists. Buhari is quoted. Might just really explain why that attack happened yesterday, you know, very close to the airport and the Air Force base. ISWAP insurgents bomb Maiduguri as president visits Borno. Underneath the bold caption, away from that, Federal Executive Council okays 16 power projects at 31.36 billion naira, $65.61 million, 15.15 million pounds. Away from that, Omicron, federal government may issue restrictions on gatherings, impose curfews. That's also another caption you find underneath, below the paper. 2022 polls. You find Bami Daly declares for a Kitty Guba race. And UAE suspends entry to arrivals from Nigeria, Kenya, two others. Panic in Abuja and Enverns as terrorists plan attack. Gunmen abduct four worshippers inside Taraba Mosque. Commissioner dumps Matawalle's cabinet and join Hope Uzodinma's government. And Sanwo-Olu empowers 1,786 farmers with 3.6 billion naira. Now, this is some of the headlines on the Daily Independent newspaper.
Now to the Punch newspapers. Big one there says NIS warns of foreign terror attacks as federal government heightens security. Nigerian and Algerian terrorists on the way from Mali to invade Abuja. Plan can never work. FCT security network intact, says Guard Brigade. Strategies in place to avert attacks. No cause for alarm, says Immigration. Also, divorce. We're probing possible hacking of Olori Naomi's Instagram page, says the Orni's Palace. Okay. Lagos declares Magodo invasion unwarranted. Vows to prosecute culprits. And also on the Punch, ex-NSCDC commandant forfeits 60 buildings and land to federal government over corruption. Reps deliberate on NYSE fund. Firms may donate 1% profit. And five killed as terrorists bomb Maiduguri airport area ahead of Buhari's visit. We can also find on the Punch, Khan kicks as federal government limits religious gatherings to 50%. Darkness looms as six power plants halt operations over gas shortage. That's all on the Punch this morning.
All right, let's take a look at the Leadership newspaper. President Muhammadu Buhari promises to end insecurity as explosion rocks Maiduguri. That's a bold caption for the Leadership this morning. Says Nigeria in final phase of war against terrorists. Troops kill 51 terrorists and police rescue 48 kidnapped victims in Kaduna. Now, ahead of the 2023 polls, IBB endorses Osinbajo for president. That's also another caption. Christmas, despite cash squeeze, Nigerians flood markets and parks. That's what you also find here. An ex-NSCDC deputy commandant forfeits 60 houses to federal government. And the palace faults rumors separation of Oni and wife. Governor Boni signs 163.9 billion naira 2022 budget into law. Now, these are the headlines on the Leadership newspaper this morning.
And quickly on The Guardian this morning, oil spills hit 14 million liters as Shell's 800 billion naira judgment upsets industry. Darkness looms as gas shortage hits Genkos. Also, broadcast stations get February 17 deadline to renew licenses. COVID-19, federal government restricts religious gatherings to 50% capacity. And also, NSCDC commandant forfeits 60 buildings and land to federal government. A day to Christmas, food and transport hike dampen celebrations. and police foil kidnap attempt of 48 people in Kaduna. Julia Johnson, good morning, and once again, thanks for joining us. I guess we should kick off with the story from the Federal Capital Territory with the Nigerian Immigration Service warning of a possible attack on the FCT by terrorists from Mali and the Niger Republic. Let's start with that.
What's the best way to start, except for us to start with a major issue that has always characterized the front pages of news over the last 10 years or thereabout, is the issue of security and insecurity. Now, the president on one hand is saying that we are in the final phase against terrorists, yet the president visited Maiduguri in Kano State, and there were bombs in explosion, rather rocks, Maiduguri. Situate that with another headline in the newspaper, across the newspapers, NIS warns of foreign attacks. And then situate that with what the Abuja Security Network said, that they are fully prepared to handle any security challenges that may rear up its head during this yellow tide period. We don't need a soothsayer to tell us that at this particular point in time of the year, when people know, when non-state actors, terrorist groups, and all other people that want to foment violence, that to pursue their religious or political ideology, and this is the period they exploit to gain maximum attention and maximum impact. In essence, it calls for both security agencies and government to put their house in order to deal with the security threats to life and properties of people. If you check other crimes, what would they do at this season? They will raise the security at either to level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4, level 5. But we don't have any level in Nigeria. They don't even tell us, but I'm sure we are at level 5, which is a critical stage, because even the president cannot travel to any part of Nigeria without an advance party, without security agencies not being mobilized to go and ensure that whichever species is going to use during his visit are secured. So the issue of security was one of the critical factors that brought this government into power in 2015. Have we been able to address it? Are we playing politics with the life of the people? Are we hear funds being, I'm sure at the end of this administration, a lot of things will come to light with respect to the resources that we have expended in providing security. And in actual sense, whether we actually provided those security. Because on one hand, from a political point of view, the president will say we are winning the war. On the other hand, we will see signals and evidences. I was watching the news yesterday where the emir of Wasi said 50% of their land has been taken over by terrorists, 50%. And I saw a lot of farmlands destroyed. Now, whether there will be foreign attacks or no foreign attacks, when ISIS was decimated, when they were decimated from Syria, Iran, and Iraq in Syria, in Turkey, and then in Iraq, they moved over to West Africa. Now, when they moved over to West Africa, a lot of analysts, security analysts, raised issues concerning ISWAP gaining ground ahead of Boko Haram. What did we do? We label it banditry, we label it on manners of the government did not come out to label them terrorists. And we have seen that in Zamfara State, in Kaduna State, just 2 days ago, all the Islamic scholars and imams in Kaduna State beckoned on the president to declare a state of emergency in the northwest and in the northeast, and particularly in Niger. So the issue of insecurity is a major problem facing us. We are not in the final phase. In actual sense, we I don't think that we have a template of dealing with this particular issue. If after 6 years of this 6 years plus of this administration, we are still talking about final phase, tell me what's the template. Tell me, we have changed security, we have changed service chiefs. Every now and then, there are one form of attack or the other. The president will command Does it require the command or the directive of the president for the chief of army staff to do his job, for the chief of defense staff to do his job? No head is rolling. Look, about two or three Fridays ago, we spoke about the Kaduna Abuja axis, where people were kidnapped. What has been done concerning that effect? Nothing. We just hear the story. We go on business as usual. Nobody was held accountable. No.
Yeah.
Security, security.
I understand.
It's.
All right, let's move away from that now. For the want of time, Omicron, federal government may issue restrictions on gatherings and impose curfew. You also have the fact that the UAE suspends entry to arrivals from Nigeria and Kenya and two others. I'd like to share your thoughts on that. I mean, this is the festive period where we're in. And
it's important, beyond imposing restriction, it is important for government to educate people through a social mobilization and awareness program. There's what we call in development communication, IECM campaign. IECM is an acronym, information for I, education, communication, and mobilization. When it comes to development communication, those four-pronged approach enables you to achieve your goal when it comes to development communication. And health communication, public health, is under, in communication studies, under development communication. I have taken the vaccine. I went out of my way this week to take the booster vaccine. I've taken the booster. I've taken three shots. That's my social responsibility as, one, a Nigerian, two, as a public commentator. I can't come on screen and be talking about COVID without me showing a degree of responsibility. What form of responsibility have public officials demonstrated across board? What form of responsibility have civil servants demonstrated across board? What level of campaign is government doing to educate people on the basis of taking the COVID? Now, there is a misconception and there is a disconnect. With respect to COVID, it's a global problem. It's a perceptual problem. And what's the perceptual problem? Is that everything the public health officials have said, they've said something contrary. There's a flip-flop when it comes to issue. Okay, stay in shelter and don't have public gathering. Okay, let's have the lockdown to slow the spread. 7 days, 15 days, 15 days to 6 months. Use face masks. It will do this, it will do that. Take the vaccine, you can't catch it. Yeah, people that have taken the vaccine are having COVID. So government and public health officials need to come straight and communicate with people, because a lot of people have a lot of misconceptions with respect to it. And I ask this question. Does COVID respect time? I'm asking this question. Does he say that, okay, you know what, I only come out in the morning, I will not come out in the evening? I'm asking.
Absolutely.
Does he
not
tell people that, okay, I'll come out in the morning, I'll not come out in the evening? What role does curfew play in mitigating against the spread of COVID? I'm asking this question. And when government says, okay, we are going to place restrictions on people's gathering, what measures are we placed to encourage people to take vaccine? What public health? Okay, if you take that restriction, in people coming in buses, in going to the marketplaces, and that's why you see Tan has kicked against government talking about limiting gatherings to 50%. I said it on tape, it's on record, even in the height of COVID. I've said it from my own study as a researcher, and as a public commentator, and as a journalist. The way I have never seen where they've used lockdown to treat a pandemic is you isolate the sick, you keep them in the hospital, you treat them, and you allow others to continue with their life. It is herd immunity that is used to deal with. There's no measure that has not been tried to deal with this particular issue. And with a benefit of insight, everyone will agree that what we are facing in terms of economic challenges globally, in terms of inflation, in terms of unemployment, in terms of dislocation, in terms of mental health, is as a result of the lockdown we went into last year. And what role did lockdown do in mitigating against the spread of COVID-19? Now we have Omicron. towards, I think, about 2 or 3 or 4 months ago, we had Delta variant. I think that was the Easter season. We had Delta variant. Now we have, which variant are we going to have next year? And then, are we going to remain in a perpetual state of lockdown or a perpetual state of fear? And I've said it, for me, growing up, and even in my adulthood, medical science does not predict, does not take a position of fear. Medical science always gives hope. But for the very first time in my lifetime, I have seen a situation whereby government officials and public health officials are promoting fears. Science does not promote fear. Science gives hope. Everything about COVID-19 is about control, fear. And that's not medical science. And I stand to be challenged or corrected on this. There's no particular issue or challenges that you take to science that science does not give you. But you know the science of COVID. The science of COVID is fear.
All right, Jide Johnson.
Lockdown and control.
Yeah, all right.
Let's go to politics.
Yeah, now let's...
Let's go to politics.
Let's go to another story on the Punch this morning. I found pretty interesting. It says that ex-NSCDC commandant forfeits 60 buildings and land to federal government over corruption.
Nothing will happen. We just hear it on the pages of newspaper. If one person will have 60 buildings, one, plus one, who is the accountant? Who is the auditor? Who is the director of finance in that organization where that man stole the amount of money he stole to have 60 buildings minus the one he wasted, minus the one he gave out as gifts? He could not have stolen the money alone. Who are others that join him? It's not possible for you to steal money alone in public service. Who are others? Why isolate him? Who are other culprits? So they will just say it on the page of newspaper. Is it for feature alone? He should be prosecuted and sent to jail. That's just one agency and probably one office. Yet, it's on record. It's on YouTube. Go and see it from day one. I have said it when people used to say this administration is fighting and deceiving yourself. We are fighting corruption on the pages of newspaper. They will just feed us with stories and what have you. This is the first time you see building from someone. This is the first time as arrogant.
Absolutely not.
You have not seen any civil servant being prosecuted. In this particular case, you investigate it thoroughly. Who are those? There's an auditor. There is the Due Process Act that talks about how you can release funds and how contracts and public funds can be released. So the auditor, the accountant, the director of finance, all those that gave approving authority and the release of what happened to them. What's that really?
Yeah. Okay.
They're only fighting corruption on the pages of newspaper. Let's go to politics, Osarugi, because it's getting interesting. There's a particular story that says IBP endorses Osinbajo for 2023.
It's on the leadership that newspaper.
That will cause ripple effect in my state, from Lagos State. And it will cause ripple effect in southwest part of Nigeria. IBP is endorsing Osinbajo. And then some people have gathered themselves together to say they will go to court to ensure that Osinbajo contests the presidency using youth earnestly. I think we should have youth earnestly ask for Osinbajo, just like we have youth earnestly ask for Abacha, using the Abacha style. Sometimes people think that we are fools in this country. They think that we don't have a sense of history. That's why they said they shouldn't teach history in schools again, so that they can fool us. Well, it's not left for those calling for Osinbajo to contest, and now that he said he has accepted responsibility, or for IBP to endorse Osinbajo. It is left for us Nigerians to determine who should be our president. And come 2023, people should not wait for. We are not looking for a reluctant president. Let people declare. Let them declare their interest. But I've told those that care to listen, there's nobody in the history of Nigeria, nobody has ever become the president having an aspiration to become the president. No, not even Shagari, not even the ceremonial president in 1963, which is Nnamdi Azikiwe. He wanted to become a prime minister. Not even Shagari that wanted to become a senator. Not even Obasanjo that went to the prison for them to release him to come and contest the presidency. Not even Jonathan. Not even Yadua. Not even Buhari. Buhari in 2011 wept openly and said he's not going to contest the presidency again until they formed APC and they went to bring him. So we have always had reluctant president. Reluctant president. President that are not. History have shown that those that are desperate for that position, they never get that position. And they never get that position. Let people declare their interest, whether they have interest or not. Not saying that, oh, you know what, Nigerians are asking for me, using Abacha style, or asking IBB. Is IBB the best character to someone that truncated June 12th, that truncated the demo, to be the one that were endorsed? So they know what they are doing. The actors and players are the same. And that's why I've told all Nigerians, for them to understand this. Don't kill yourself because APC or PDP. It is the same set of power class that has been ruling us since independence that are still there. They are just changing their color over time. Let's move to Ekiti. You know, in Ekiti, Bamidele has declared his intention to run for the governor, to run for the governor of I watched it on TV and I saw 21 senators following him to go and collect the form. Those 21 senators, I hope they can visit their respective states. I hope those 21 senators will have taken and should have gone to meet the chief of army staff, the chief of defense staff, and talk about security challenges facing Nigeria. What was they care about this political power? And someone has asked me, would there be election in 2020? I told the president, there will be election in 2023. There will be peace. There won't be crisis. The political class, the actors, and the non-state actors and the political class, they work in tandem. So they will speak to one another. There will be relative peace. Just like people felt that there won't be election in Anambra State. We saw the election came and it was peaceful. Now, in few months' time, we'll have a transition to a new government by January in Anambra State. That's the thing that will pervade the atmosphere in 2023 in Nigeria. Let me quickly end with this. It's unfortunate that journalists are perpetuating illiteracy in this country. Journalists. And that's why there's a particular strand of study in media and communication study, which is called media literacy. Now, look at the way this newspaper, both the editors and the journalists in this particular niche, I won't mention the newspaper. See the way they crafted this story. It's not a new story. This is a PR stunt. It said Sanwo-Olu empowers 1,000. I'm coming.
1,786 farmers with 3.6 billion naira.
Appeal project is an appeals project. Appeal project is a one bank, federal government assisted and participating state project. So it is not even Lagos State one alone. It's a one bank project under the auspices of the federal government, and which is a program designed for women and youth. And look at how this newspaper crafted someone lose money. You know, say Lagos State government empowers. It is not someone. That's what gave that NDDC chairman the right to steal public fund. Because the narrative we give to issue is that anyone occupying public office, whatever he does, he's doing it in his personal capacity. Buhari does this. It's not Buhari, it's federal government of Nigeria. Have you ever seen federal government of Nigeria? If you want to say Obama's administration, Donald Trump administration, Buhari's administration, Sanwo-Olu's administration. Not Sanwo-Olu. This is the height of illiteracy perpetuated by the media. And it's unfortunate. And we are the one that build people in public office to become authoritarian, to become despotic, for them to have a false sense of image that they don't have. And that's why you have seen people, when they leave public service, they become irrelevant because they are given a false sense of identity which they don't have. They become irrelevant. We are the governors. We are the class of 1999 governors. We are the class of 2007. The moment they leave office, they become irrelevant.
Right.
And I'm told those that care to listen and all their managers and people managing them. Why do you bother yourself in putting your images on public, information material? It's the state government. The state has a logo. You don't need to put your images because it's just a matter of time. Whether it's 4 or 8 years, your images will be irrelevant.
Yeah.
I keep asking you this. Where is the image of Ambodi? Where is the image of Tinubu? Where is the image of Fashola? Where is that of Jonathan? Where is that of Obasanjo? And we must, as journalists, as the watchdog, there is a constitutional responsibility placed on us. One, he said, Section 22 of 1999 Constitution as amended, said the media shall be the watchdog of the society and shall hold government accountable at all times. Is this accountability? This is irresponsibility.
Right.
It's not someone who empowers the quickly. Power. It is Lagos State government.
Yeah.
And that's the way the story should be written.
Yeah, Judah Johnson, quickly, let's get you to also share something from The Guardian this morning. It's at the bottom of The Guardian. It says, a day to Christmas, food and transport hike dampen celebration. So just, you know, you can wrap up with talking about 2021's Christmas celebrations across Nigeria. It doesn't seem like it's you know, the best one yet.
And just to add, you know, because there's another narrative on, you know, the leadership that says that despite cash squeeze, Nigerians flood markets and parks. So, I mean, whose report do we believe?
Well, you know, whichever way, people will always make time to celebrate the season. They will go out of their way. Some will get loans. Some will get largesses from family and friends. I'm sure you have received a lot of text messages because they see you on the screen and they think you have all the money in the world from family and friends for you to ask. Messi smiling. So basically, people will still try to make their children and their family happy. They will go out of their way for this particular season. But we knew quite all right that, one, the lockdown created a dislocation and a disruption of society, disrupted the economy. We knew this 2021, we are going to face inflation. Two, in Nigeria, to domesticate it, apart from facing the disruption of COVID-19, we had the disruptions of farmers-herders clash and the growth of banditry, but which I call terrorism in Nigeria, and which would ultimately affect production of foods, and any nation that cannot feed itself is facing a major security challenge. In fact, food is seen as a security issue. So the challenges we are facing now will be more in 2022 because all the factors are there. There's a principle that God established. I'm a Christian by faith. There's a principle God established, he said, as long as the earth remains, seed time and harvest time shall not cease. Aristotle called that law of cause and effect. He called it law of cause and effect, seed time and harvest time. Whatever you should do, you want to have an effect, you must be committed to a cause. What causes are we taking to address the issue of destruction of farmlands, to address the issue of disruption of the society as a result of the lockdown, with people not going to work? What cause are we taking to when government was pumping too much money through traders' money, through palliative, through without engaging in giving people for productive issues? And they said they are going to remove oil subsidy in 2023, and they are going to give 5,000 naira to 40 million poor Nigerians. Where they got that figure from? Only God will help them. So when you don't have a constructive policy to deal with the issue caused by the disruption of the COVID-19 pandemic and your internal problem of farmers' herders' clash, insecurity, banditry, and the rest of it, then you have the challenges that we are facing now. And I have not seen any step that government has taken to address this. I'm not a prophet of doom. Something that happened in the day of Elijah might happen in Nigeria. But if you look good by natural cause, the effect in 2023 will be food will become more expensive, the inflation will be on the increase, and because the inflation will be on the increase because government is making various attempts to inject more money into the economy, giving money to the people. And when you have too much money pursuing few goods, prices will rise. And government is also imposing, we impose taxation. Taxation, different form of taxation and levies on the people in 2023. And that's right. But hopefully, joy comes with the Christmas season. We hope the joy of the hopefully. Christmas season will come on all our public officials and they will do the right thing at the right time. You guys are looking beautiful.
Thank you.
You guys are looking. I wish you Merry Christmas.
Same to and, you, Johnson.
Happy. See you on the 31st. As we wrap up the year in view.
Absolutely. Thank you very much for your
enjoy
time.
Enjoy your holidays. Enjoy your holidays.
Thank you, GD Johnson. We appreciate it.
Thanks, of course, for staying with us so far. That was, of course, Off the Press. We'll take a short break. We'll move to, of course, sharing with you what happened on this day, the 24th of December, many, many years ago. Today in history, we'll be back.